Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So say that I do not choose my destiny, but I discover my destiny. Is that true? So are you supposed to choose your destiny? Huh? No. You have to discover the destiny. And how are you going to discover God's destiny for your life? The one important factor is offering your life as a living sacrifice. Now, there is one area in our life that we tend to fall again and again, and that's called offense. What's offense? Do you get offended? Yes. Only one person. Do we get offended? Yes. Even the youth? Because we people have got responsibility of our children and finances and all those things. But youth also get, what about children in school? They also get offended? Yeah, praise God. So offense is extremely common, and we feel that getting offended is natural for a Christian life. Now, what is the meaning of the word offense? Okay. And you give me only half the definition. What is offense? If possible, please write it. Offense is my negative reaction. Offense is my negative reaction to a situation or to people's comment. My negative reaction to a situation or people's comment. Just put the PowerPoint. Praise God. So remember, Jesus gave his disciples only one commandment. And that commandment is, love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, mind and strength. Praise God. And love one another as I have loved you. Praise God. So the whole Christian life, the foundation is love. Wherever there is love, there is God. And this love is not a selfish love. This love is one-sided love, means whether you do good to me or you don't do good to me, I will still be good to you and love you. And that's God's love. When we were sinners, we were his enemies, we rebelled against him, but yet God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall believe shall not perish, but have eternal life. Praise God. So Satan knows that as long as a person walks in love, that person will live an undefeated life. So if he wants to destroy a person's future, a person's destiny, then he must bring pressure into somebody's life so that he will refuse to walk in love and walk in offense. So it is extremely important for us to continually walk in the love of God in order to avoid becoming offended. Now, in a day, we come across so many people, and so many people respond according to their will. So many things that happen unjustly. So many times we are falsely accused. Now, in the midst of all these things that are happening, is it possible for a person to quickly react in a negative way? Yes. So when a person reacts in a negative way, is he offering himself as a living sacrifice? No. Now, is he living according to his natural ability, natural human ability? Now, when he is walking in that ability, is he walking in love? No. If he is not walking in love, is he now connected to God? No. It is just like a fuse that just got blasted and there is a short circuit. Now, there is no more fellowship with God. Now, there is only fellowship with Satan. God's power is cut off from that person's life. Now, did God cut it off, or the person who got offended cut it off? So God is saying to us that it is extremely important for us to focus, that if I want to experience victory, if I want God's destiny to be revealed to me, if I want to reach to the highest point that God has planned for my life, plans for my welfare, then I must train myself. No matter how people treat me, I will walk in love. Now somebody will say, if people treat me like dirt, you mean to say as a Christian I should keep on bearing all that? Listen, when people treat you like dirt and you begin and you're still walking in love, that's the time God will take over the battle and he will fight for you. But if you refuse to walk in love, then you are saying, God, you don't fight the battle, I will fight my own battle. But now when you're fighting your own battle, are you fighting your battle with love or with offense? And if you're fighting the battle with offense, remember, James 3 says, 14, 15, 16 and 17, it says, when a person is offended, when a person is bitter, such kind of thoughts are devilish, demonic. And such a person is in confusion, and from such a person will happen every evil thing. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 So Satan will try his best to do everything in his power to get us to step outside the love of God. Now, Satan knows that as long as this person walks in love, he cannot be defeated. So what will Satan do? He will use somebody or the other. Many a times the person doesn't even know that he's working for Satan. He will use somebody to create a negative emotion in you. He'll put pressure on your love walk with one another. And the moment you get offended, you have just come out of God's protection and you are now in the open. Now Satan can surely make your life miserable. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now I can say, Lord, cover me with your precious blood. Lord, protect me. Lord, all those prayers. And when the pressure comes, I'm the first person to get frustrated. I'm the first person to react. I'm the first person to open my mouth and abuse. I'm the first person to fight back. Now, will that blood of Jesus protect you? So what does Satan need to do? He needs to only get you offended. Now, in a day, how many things happen against you? Now, this sister is talking to this sister outside. Okay, she's just standing outside. They just started talking. And I said, what are you doing here? You came for the retreat to talk? Go and sit there. Okay? Now, the words that I spoke to her, is there a chance to get offended? Yes. And if you got offended, what happened? Your whole retreat is gone for a toss. So are you, if you see people who are extremely sensitive, sensitive means in their emotions, they get quickly triggered in their emotion, sensitive for small things. You look at their lives, even though they will be a champion in praying, but if they continue to live a life of being extremely sensitive, their life is extremely miserable. Do you know why? Because that person is not walking in love. That person is out of the protection zone. That person will be attacked, made miserable by the devil. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Put the next one. So once we step outside the love circle, the power of God is short-circuited. Let's say the fuse got blown off in the main junction box. Will any of these instruments work? Will it work? When will it start working? When you'll start praying. Very good. When somebody will go and replace the fuse. In the same way, if you are walking in offense and you're praying, my friend, it's not going to change the situation, because your fuse is still blown off till you make the decision to replace the fuse. So what does Satan need to do in your life? He needs to put somebody who hates you, somebody who hurts you, somebody who accuses you, somebody who curses you, somebody who does all kinds of nasty things against you, so that you react. Praise God. Can I ask you a question? What if somebody has to curse you? Will you get offended? Hello? What's the meaning of the word cursing somebody? That's what you did not understand. What is cursing? Cursing is not wishing something bad for somebody only. Okay, I'll give you the definition of curse according to Jesus. Okay, you remember Jesus was one day very hungry. And when he was hungry, he saw a fig tree from a distance. And it was covered with leaves. Now those leaves said, the character of a fig tree is, when it is covered with leaves, it bears fruit at the same time. So looking at the leaves, he believed that there should be fruit. And when he went and searched for the fruit was not there. And when he did not find the fruit, what did Jesus do? The Bible says Jesus answered and said to the tree. That means the tree spoke to Jesus and said, what are you searching for? And he said, figs. Why are you searching for figs? It's not the season for figs now. And he said, but you showed me the leaves, and the character of a tree is what? When there are leaves, there are fruits. Because he is the one who created the tree. He is the one who put that character in the tree. And the Bible says Jesus answered. Let me show you. Just put that Mark 11, I think 13, 14, 15. Just see 13, 14, 15. Mark 11. Okay, after that. Can you see that word Jesus? Jesus answered. The Bible doesn't say Jesus said to the tree. Jesus answered. When will somebody answer? When somebody has questioned. So did the tree question Jesus? Hello, did the tree question Jesus? Did the tree question Jesus? I'm asking you, did the tree question Jesus? Can you give me that chair, please? Yeah, the broken one, yeah. Yeah, can you give me the chair? Yes. Now, is this chair talking to you? Now, when I decided to sit, some of them said, my God. Correct? Am I sitting comfortable? I have no problem, because my mind said that I cannot put my weight behind. As long as I put my weight on the legs in front, I have no issues. Okay? Now let's say this chair was okay, absolutely okay, and the chair broke right before your eyes. You saw it. Will this chair talk to you about your chair? Because if you are of my size, surely your chair will also talk to you. Hello.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. In the same way, can the tree talk to Jesus?
Yes.
Yeah, surely. And that's why when the tree spoke to Jesus asking, what are you looking for? And Jesus must have said to himself, I'm looking for figs. And the tree said, why are you looking for figs? And Jesus said, I saw the leaves. That's why the previous scripture clearly says that, just put that 13. He saw a fig tree from far off having leaves. When you see a tree from far and if there are less leaves, then you will see like the tree is naked. But even after seeing the tree from a distance, he can still see the tree is covered with leaves. That means this tree was completely covered with leaves. That means this tree has to be completely also covered with fruit, because the leaves and the fruit come at the same time. When I was in Turkey, there was a garden of figs. And I did not know that was a fig tree. And when I went there, you know, it was a big orchard of all the fig trees. And I asked the nun, why are these trees all dead? She said, they are not dead, they are alive. I said, they are only sticks. And she said, it's not the season now. I said, what do you mean it's not the season? She said, this is a fig tree. I was excited. I said, I've got some questions to ask you. I just saw that this tree looks, that there's not a single leaf, so this tree looks to be dead. And she said, no, next month when you come, this tree will be covered with leaves. I said, that's fantastic. Now tell me one more thing. When this tree is covered with leaves, will there be figs? She said, definitely there will be figs. I saw a tree without leaves. And she said, when you come next month, this tree will be covered with leaves. And next month when the leaves come, the fruit comes at the same time. Now look at what Jesus said. 14. Isn't that comfortable? Hello. I'm sitting on one leg. Why is it comfortable? Definitely. Praise God. So can a person even sit on a three leg? Yes. But when his mind is not attentive and he goes behind, then everything will go. Behind will go right in the air. Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay, let's see. Jesus answered and said to it, no man eat fruit of you hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. Now, did Jesus speak to the tree something negative? So what did Jesus do? He only spoke a negative word to the tree and it died. So when you speak negative about somebody, you are actually cursing that somebody. It's not necessary that you need to wish something negative to that person. The very thing that you're speaking negative about somebody, you just curse that somebody. And if you curse that somebody, that curse will come back 100-fold. I like the expression on your face. You are shocked. You mean to say every time I speak something negative about somebody, might be I'm speaking negative about my husband, I'm speaking negative about my wife, I'm speaking negative about my children, I'm speaking negative about my in-laws. When I'm speaking negative about somebody, I just cursed. And if I just curse, the Bible says what you sow will come back to you in multiples. So if you know people who keep on talking negatives about everybody around, they are cursing every day. So when you're cursing, curse will come on you in multiples. But there is another person who has been done wrong by somebody. He doesn't speak the negative things about that person, but he speaks the good things that is there in that person. What is he doing? Blessing that person. And when you go around blessing people, blessings of God will come on you. So when somebody is hurting you, what comes out of your mouth? So whom did you curse? So when you curse that somebody, what happens to the curse? It turns around and comes back to you in multiples. So what's the devil's game? The devil's game is that he has to use somebody to irritate you. And when you get irritated, you get offended, you open your mouth, you do all those things, you just planted a corruptible seed, which is like a time bomb coming back onto your life and destroying you. Praise God. What do you do when somebody curses you? Now, you did not curse somebody, but what happens when somebody says, I will curse you, and that person curses you? What do you do now? Take the shield of faith. Very good. How do you get the shield of faith? Yeah, which word will you take then? When somebody has cursed you really bad, those words keep coming to you and you keep on remembering and you keep playing that tape again and again. Okay. Let's say somebody close to you, whom you love the most, cursed you. When somebody close to you curses, you remember it again and again, the one who loves you. Oh yeah? Oh yeah? Somebody whom you love, it hurts, and you don't play those words again. Don't tell lies. Yeah, it hurts. That means that words are talking to you. That's why it hurts. Yes. Now I'm going to show you that it will not hurt you. You don't want, forget it. No, because anyway, your life is not the same as it was before. So let's not talk it. Because you already know it. Praise God. I thought I will give you a good formula, but you already, you are not falling into the trap. So why should I give you that formula? Forget it now. Now somebody over there is saying, brother, that's offense from your part, because we just said, now you are offended and you are reacting and you don't want to give it. See how quickly, yes, now you are offended. Okay, I'll give you a scripture. See, the next time somebody says, you know, I'm going to do occult witchcraft, black magic and all those things on you, and nothing will save you, nothing can protect you, I will see you, I will fix you up. Genesis 12:1, 2, and 3. Is it possible if we have dinner tonight a little late?
Yes.
Around, say, 9 o'clock?
Yes.
You won't get offended?
No.
Okay. Thank you very much. Genesis 12:1, 2, and 3. And now the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out of your country and from your kindred and from your father's house unto the land that I will show you. Verse number 2. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. Look at verse 3. And I will bless them. Please read it. And I will bless them that bless you, and curse them that curse you, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. So God said to Abraham, listen, Abraham, I want to tell you, anyone who blesses you, I will bless that person. Anyone who curses you, I will curse that person. And not only that, in you shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, this is a promise that God gave to Abraham. And God made a covenant with Abraham and said, listen, Abraham, I make a covenant with you that you and your descendants shall be blessed. Now, are you a descendant of Abraham? Are you a Jew? You mean to say Abraham came to Goa? I can understand you get the passport of Portuguese. Now you are also claiming a passport for Israel. You will get no Portuguese passport. Go on. So now you want Israeli passport also. So you are going to go to the consulate and say, I am a descendant of Abraham, so I need a... Okay, Galatians 3:29. See, if you say something, show me the proof. When you want a Portuguese passport, do you send some documents?
Yes.
Or you only say, I'm a Goan?
No. The
supporting documents. So what is your supporting document? Galatians 3:29. If you be in Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Now, are you, see that brother is already clapping. He says, wow, I now understand I am a descendant of Abraham. And if I am a descendant of Abraham, what God blessed Abraham, it's mine. So can somebody come and curse me now? Hey, you curse me, you are in trouble, not me. You want to go and do some occult black magic on me, go ahead and do it. But you are in trouble, my God will curse you. That's why in the Old Testament, God said, I will curse you. But in the New Testament, God said, love your enemies. Why do you think he said, love your enemies? Jesus said, love your enemies. You know why? Because when somebody comes against you, and you are in Christ Jesus, that somebody coming against you does not affect you. It goes back in multiples and destroys that person. That person can only be saved by your love. So when you pray for that person, when you love that person, the curse that that person has put on you gets cancelled by your love and that person is saved. So who is supposed to be scared of whom? So if somebody is cursing you, they should be scared. Now, you are not only going to make them scared, but you are going, because you are filled with love, you are going to pray for that person, and your prayer and your love will save that person. So now, does anybody want to make some mess with me? So the next time somebody says, you know, there's somebody done black magic or occult on you. Now what will you say? Hey, listen, that's bad news for them. You won't say, that's bad news for me. You'll say, bad news for them. And the person will say, why? Because according to the law, according to the scriptures, in Christ Jesus, I'm a descendant of Abraham. And according to the scripture, God is going to curse that person. But if I operate in love, then God will look at that and forgive them and show mercy on them and cancel the curse. Can we give the Lord a big hand? Tell me honestly, you went for some counseling, okay? And you are in trouble. Some problems again and again, those troubles come. And the counselor said, you know your next door neighbor? He wants your property. And he has put a curse on you, a spell on you, and an occult on you. Now, whenever you see that neighbor having received this message, will you be at peace? Come on. Will you be at peace? What will come out of you? Bitterness, revenge, curses, and all this. Now the counselor gave you this message and you have this message. Now what will you tell the counselor? That's bad news, really bad news for that person. And the counselor say, listen, that person did an occult and witchcraft on you, so it's a bad news for you. And you say, no, that's not a bad news for me, because according to the scripture, as for me, God said, I will bless those who bless me. If he is not blessing me, he can't get any blessing. And if he's cursing me, then God says he will curse him. There are many counselors who do not know the truth. Their job is whenever anybody comes with trouble, the first thing they say, there's a curse on your life. Somebody has done something on you. And what amazes me, when God gives them all these messages, I don't know why God does not give them the power to remove those curses. Good. Then? Thank God. But that thought must have depressed you. That thought will give you fear. Praise God. So are you going to get worried the next time somebody says there's somebody who has done something on you? In fact, you are going to say that's bad news for that person. Lord, please forgive that person. Have mercy on that person. And cancel those things that are coming against that person. It can't come against me. Because the one who is dwelling in me, Christ, is far greater than the occult which is coming from outside. Because the one in me is far greater. He can fix it up. Hallelujah. So will I get offended? No. You know, yesterday night after I went back and I said, God, you gave the fantastic teaching yesterday when that insect came and sat on my finger. If I believed that that insect had more power over me, I would have got scared. Is it right? But if I know that this insect cannot harm me, then I'm not scared. Yeah, you can have some fun on my finger. Praise God, that's all. In the same way, if somebody is cursing me and I know that curse has no power over me, it will not bother me. If somebody is doing something against me and I know that it has no power over me because I'm going to do God's way, so I will not react. In fact, I'll feel sorry for him because he is in trouble, not me. So are we supposed to react or act? A person who is offended always reacts. A person who walks in love acts. So are you acting or reacting? What's the meaning of reacting? That fellow does, you do it, two fingers, that's reaction. Praise God. Yeah, put the slide, please. So once we step outside the love circle, the power of God is short-circuited. Everything in the kingdom of God is based on love. Everything in the kingdom of God is based on love. Therefore, we must choose to love even when we are offended. Natural human nature will keep on jumping out. Give back, even if you can't give back, go to the washroom, shut the door, open your mouth, and now give back. Possible? Hello, possible? If the boss is irritating again and again and again, tears are flowing, and you get up from your seat, the boss thinks now she's broken and she's going to wash her face. She shuts the door, stands there and curses him. Will he know that she cursed him? But will that seed get activated instantly? Yes. Now it's a choice. Even though I'm offended, even though I'm mean, and the devil is saying, open your mouth, curse him. No, I will not. And if I don't curse him, I just won the battle. Are you following? Now are you enjoying playing chess? And your opponent, whether you like it or not, is the devil whom you can't see. But do we have his moves? Yeah. Do we have God teaching us his moves? Yeah. So which move are we going to take? God's or the Satan's? And if you are following Satan's, then every time he says checkmate. Okay. Next slide, please. I like that. Read that. If we say we love God, see, it is impossible, it is extremely impossible to say it to, for a person to say, I love God very much. He is such an intimate relationship with God and I'm lost in his love, and that same person hates somebody. Impossible. Because when a person loves God, that person is saying, I'm willing to die to myself completely in obedience to God. Have you heard that song? God's love is so wonderful. God's love is so wonderful. Oh, you don't know that song? Wow, wonderful love. No, enough. What is this God's love? Hello, what is this God's love? Is it an emotion? Is it a feeling? Huh? I'm asking you, this God's love, is it a feeling? So, you mean to say fake love is a feeling? So, every time some people get feeling, that it means it's a fake? John chapter 2 verse 5. The one who keeps his word, in him is the love of God perfected. Praise God. Whosoever keeps his word, in him truly is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. So who are the people who experience the love of God? Now, for example, Saint Francis Xavier, we were studying in the evening. He was given an option. His parents said, "You choose." Which one did he choose? God's word? Or his emotions, his feelings, and all those things? Now, when he chose God's word and he kept God's word and he lived by God's word, did he experience the love of God? Now, when he experienced the love of God, did he hate his parents? Did he hate anybody? No. So, the more and more I experience the love of God, the more and more love flows towards others. And if a person who is coming against me, I do not feel angry for that person. I feel sorry for that person. Why do I feel sorry for that person? I feel sorry for that person because this person is totally blinded. Yes, there was a time when I also used to react. Yes, there was a time when I did not know the truth. But it is God who opened my mind. He is the one who opened my blindness. And now I understand that when I walk in love, it gives me victory. And if I am a person who keeps God's word, the Bible says, I will first of all experience God's love. See, I cannot give to somebody what I don't have. So before I can give somebody something that I have, I must receive that something. So when I'm keeping God's word, or when I'm obeying God's word, when I'm meditating on God's word, when I'm thirsting for more and more and more and more of God's word, at that time I don't receive more love. I draw more love out. See. Normally, what do we believe? God will give me more love. Hello. God will give me more love. There's a song also. More love, more power, more of you in my life. No. Do we want more of God in our life? Or God wants more of us in our life? See. When God stepped into us, did he come with only half body or did he come full? So do you want more? Or we are already full. So to experience that fullness, what do we need to do? We need to die more. And the more I die, the more I experience him. Now, when I experience him, he's not giving me more, but I'm able to draw more out of him. Okay, let me show you. Romans 5, verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad or will be shed abroad. So the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost which is given unto us. So he's saying the day you got born again, at that time when the Holy Spirit walked in, he did not walk in half. Have you ever heard that, you know, double portion of the anointing? You know, Elisha received double portion of Elijah's anointing. So we also say, Lord, I want double. Now, in the Old Testament, it was possible double. In the New Testament, it's not possible double, because the fullness of God dwells in us. Now, this fullness of God who dwells in us is dwelling in our spirit. So the more and more we renew our mind, the more and more the love of God flows. Example. According to this scripture, has God poured his love into me? Now, is the love already in me? Yes. Now, I have a nature of reacting. I have a nature of getting frustrated. I have a nature of hating. I have a nature of being bitter and angry. Okay? So, when I'm talking to this sister and she's speaking to me something that is hurting me, what would be my reaction? Instant offense. But now when I'm looking at the scriptures, and the scriptures is saying, if I walk in offense, I've walked out of God's love, I've short-circuited God's power. I've got two choices. One, the thoughts that are irritating me, instigating me to get angry. I cannot get angry without thoughts. First, I get some thoughts that trigger me to get angry. Is it right? In the same way, this word of God also gives me thoughts and triggers me to forgive. So, when I am using the scriptures to trigger me to forgive, I am actually drawing love which he has already poured into me in the life of others. So this sister always sees that I'm all the time reacting. But this time she sees, hey, that was cool, man. How come today, what day it is, man? This fellow did not react. What happened to him? She is surprised. Next time she does something else. Again, she sees that this fellow is not reacting. Now, the power to love her, the power to forgive her, is already poured in my heart. But this love which is in my heart to flow from my body into her has to pass through the mind. And this mind is where I get offended, and this mind is where I pour love. Hello? Because this is the place where the processing is going on. This is the place where reaction takes place. So when thoughts are running in my mind, on one side getting bitter, on the other side God saying, listen child, I forgave you. You did so much of mistake, but I forgave you. I had mercy on you. So can you just forgive her? How many times, Lord? 7 times 77. And then you say, God, if that's what you want, I'll do it for you. Now, am I reacting? Now, will my emotions be negative, or my emotions will look at her with mercy? Now, am I drawing that power called love? Love is a power. Love is not an emotion. That's why you will see, before the Holy Spirit anointing came on the disciples, they were all the time fighting. Who is going to sit on the right? Who is going to sit on the left? Right? But on the day of Pentecost, the power of the Holy Spirit came upon them. And the Bible says in Acts 1:8, you will be filled with power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be witnesses. Now, witnesses does not mean somebody coming and giving testimony. Witnesses means even when there is a call to physically be put to death, I'm willing to be martyred and still proclaim the gospel of Christ. So he's saying, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. But he says before that, you shall be filled with power. Means what? You shall be filled with love. In the New Testament, every time you read the word power, it is love. So the more and more you operate in God's love, the more and more you see manifestation of God's love. You see more miracles happening in your life. Hallelujah. You check out a person whose life is making impact on people's life, you'll see that there is a very powerful fruit in that person's life, compassion and love. So the quicker you develop the love, the quicker you develop mercy, the quicker you'll develop compassion, the quicker you will see God's glory, God's manifestation, God's miracles in your life. Hallelujah. So every day, what's your battle? Every day your battle is only one thing. Love or bitter? No. The test is, in everything, the test is only one thing. Love or bitter? When you're God conscious, it's love. When you're self-conscious, it's bitter. And that can, this can go on and off any moment. Yeah, that's why Christian life is not somebody coming and praying over you and saying, switch on the switch on, Lord, that I will walk in love. No. It doesn't work that way. Everyone has the freedom of choice. We train our mind, we set our mind that, Lord, talk to our mind that from now on, when this happens, I'm not going to react, I'm going to act God's way. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, put the slide, please. So, if anyone says we love God, we must love others. So it's impossible to say, for a person to say, I love God very much, but at the same time hate somebody. How many times did you see after the day of Pentecost and they were filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, you saw the disciples fighting among themselves. I'm going to sit this side, I'm going to sit that side, I'm the leader. Did you see them fighting for authority, for position? Come on. They were only interested in serving. They were only interested that their bodies could be used for the kingdom of God. Just put that 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love, but perfect love cast out fear, because fear has torment. He that feared is not made perfect in love. So wherever there is love, there is no fear. So the more and more you're walking in love, and for any person to walk in love, it means the love is not an emotion, it's not a feeling. It's God Himself. God is love. Hello. God Himself is love. Right? And this love is experienced when a person is a doer of the word. And the more and more you are walking in love, the more and more you find yourself, you are living a fearless life. So when a person is walking in disobedience, is he walking in love? No. So if he is living a disobedience life, will he be experiencing guilt and condemnation? Yes. Now, will that guilt and condemnation give him confidence with God? No. So now will the devil all the time accuse you that, you know, you did this and this and this and you will be punished. So is now the person being tormented with fear? Are you getting it? So what's the devil's job? The devil's job, put the slides. The enemy tries to lure us away from God through offense. So what do you do when you're going through offense? Be quick to pray. Be quick to repent. Be quick to set your relationship with God quickly. Hallelujah. 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 Tell me honestly, when we are offended, when we are in bad mood, we can pray better. And if somebody comes to visit you and says, okay, we'll say a small prayer. I don't want anything. Possible? When do we pray better? When we are in good mood. When everything is going on fine. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But what is the Lord teaching? When we are in bad mood, when everything is going crazy, and you are all pressured, and you are offended, and all this, first thing is to run to God and ask His help to get you out from that offense. Because that offense activates devil to destroy everything that God has given you. So is it okay for a Christian to get offended? It is extremely illegal for a person to get offended, a Christian to get offended. Just like, is it easy for a Christian to be in adultery? Now, at once, now. In the same way, it is extremely illegal for a person to get offended. But we never thought that offense is so dangerous. Do you know why people go to hell? Does sin take people to hell? Hello? Does sin take people to hell? Sin doesn't take anybody to hell. Now somebody will say, what do you mean? Sin does not take people to hell. Unbelief takes people to hell. Because when a person believes, he quickly repents. He quickly asks for forgiveness. His sins are forgiven. Instead of hell, heaven becomes his eternal home. But when the same gospel is preached and the person is not willing to believe in the sacrifice of Jesus, that unbelief takes him to hell. Now when God says, don't get offended, operate in love, mercy and forgiveness, and the person says, no, I will never forgive this person. Unforgiveness spirit is extremely dangerous. It can take you to hell. Because unless we forgive others, we cannot receive forgiveness. And if we have not received forgiveness, the sin remains. And when sin remains, that sin is qualifying you to go to hell. Unforgiveness is a very dangerous spirit. And if there is a person who says, brother, I find it very difficult to forgive somebody. I find it extremely difficult to forgive somebody. I can give you a solution for that. Jesus said, whosoever says to this mountain, be lifted up and be thrown into the sea, does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, he shall have whatever he says. So now if you can speak to the mountain, you can speak to that spirit of unforgiveness dwelling in you and say to that spirit of unforgiveness, I rebuke you, I cast you out of my life, out of my body, and Lord, what I've just said, I do not doubt in my heart, I believe it's done, and Lord, you said I shall have whatever I say. So in the name of Jesus, I'm free from unforgiveness, and I thank you, Lord, for your anointing. I'm able to forgive everybody in Jesus' name. Nobody's happy. Next slide. Offense is based in selfishness. Every time you get angry, ask yourself, what do I fear? The root of every sin in a life is selfishness. The root of holiness in a life is God consciousness, selflessness. God is selfless. World is selfish. So every time we get offended, it's because of our selfishness. And the more and more the person is walking in selfishness, the person is walking in fear, because he has fear of everything. In today's world, are we having fear of insecurity of our future? Hello? What if right now there's an earthquake and we all go down and we all die? Sorry? See, he is so confident and he's saying, praise God, the next moment I'll be with the Lord. Why is he so confident? Because of his relationship. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. What is fear? Please write on what is fear. Faulty expectation. F-E, faulty expectation, assumption of reality is fear. Faulty expectation, assumption of reality is fear. So for the devil to bring fear into us, what does he need to inject in us? Lies. What did he inject Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden? Lies. What does he inject in us? Lies. God doesn't love you. God doesn't care for you. God has abandoned you. And when he puts this lies in your mind, God has abandoned you, God has abandoned you. You are saying, Jesus, don't leave me, Jesus, don't leave me. But the truth is, Jesus said, I will never leave you, never forsake you. I am with you till the end of time. Have you heard people saying, Jesus, please don't leave me? Come on. Why is that person saying, Jesus, please don't leave me? Because the devil has put fear that Jesus has left that person. But the truth says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will be with you always till the end of time. Are you understanding? So the devil plays on our mind, injecting lies, and when we do not know the truth, we accept the lies. We become, first of all, self-conscious, self-centered, and that produces fear, that produces torment, that produces insecurity, and that destroys our life. I can tell you without a doubt, because I was a champion in depression. I've been in an extreme depression. I could sit and keep on thinking on a subject for hours together and keep on crying. And when I went on the trip on the negative side for hours and hours, days and days, I went into so much of depression that a time came when I forgot my name as well. My mind was captivated by the enemy completely. I could not think right. I had only fear of death. And the only way this depression can be destroyed, depression is a tormenting evil spirit, captivating people's mind, building a stronghold of every kind of fear in that person. This can only be destroyed with the power of the Word of God and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. So when the Word of God is preached, you know, yesterday there was a lady, she could barely walk, she was sitting here. Her depression was that her son got married to a Muslim girl 3 years and she was so much tormented. Today when she came, she was smiling and she was walking around. And I said, within 24 hours I can see such a change. What happened? I said to her, the Bible says, believe in the Lord Jesus, you and your household will be saved. Do you know, from now on, thank God that your daughter-in-law has become Christian. I said, say it every day, again and again. Thank you, Jesus, my daughter-in-law is a Christian. My son and my daughter-in-law are proclaiming the word of God. Now what was she saying? Faith. Will that faith come to pass? Yes, if she continues to believe. Now, when she said those words, what happened? Her mind, which was leached by the power of the evil one, began to get unleashed with the word of God, with the Spirit of God. Say that leech. Say that leech. What is leech? Not beach. Goa always have the word beach, beach. This is not beach, leech. What's a leech? Leech is a small creature. Now when I said that gets onto your skin and hangs over there and keeps sucking the blood out of you. Until its stomach is full, it will not leave you. And you won't even know that it is sucking the blood. When the whole process is over and he has left your body, then it starts burning. Praise God. Now, just as the leech sucks the blood, sucks that life out of you, in the same way, the evil spirit is nothing but a leech. How does this happen? How does depression set in? An incident took place, an extreme negative incident, and that person was filled with sorrow. That person believed that incident and began to meditate on it. Every time the person is thinking the same thing over and over and over again, on the negative side, it is just like an airplane coming for a landing on the runway, lands and goes and parks in different places. But the runway is used. Are you understanding? So thoughts after thoughts coming and landing in your mind, without your knowledge, your mind is slowly but surely getting captivated by the enemy. When this person's mind is more and more captivated, that part of the mind the person cannot use for himself, that portion of the mind is under the control of the enemy. The more and more the person keeps on with that same process, 1 month, 2 months, 6 months, 8 months, there comes a time that that person only speaks about death. That person speaks about defeat. Why? This person's mind is completely leeched. But when that same person is brought to the session where there is the presence of God and the word of God is preached and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, all of a sudden the word of God, like a hammer, breaks the stronghold. The lies is exposed by the word of God. And when the lies is exposed, the person makes a decision to believe the word of God. The anointing of the Holy Spirit destroys what had taken years and years and years to build a stronghold or a fortress in that person's mind, is destroyed with the anointing and the word of God. Now that person begins to feed himself on the word of God more and more and more. There was a time when the mind was all the time thinking about the negative things that have happened to this person. Now that person is all the time thinking on the word of God. So there used to be a stronghold. There used to be a stronghold which was negative. What's the meaning of stronghold? It's a fort. And the person is captivated in that fort. The person doesn't come out. The person doesn't allow anybody to come in. That person's world is that captivated mind. Praise God. Then the person receives the word of God, the stronghold is broken, and now the person is meditating on the word of God day and night. What happens? The person has built a new stronghold, the word of God. This happened in Bombay. There was this mother who used to come for my Bible class when Brother Alred used to, we used to have a Bible class at home. And this mother used to, you know, every time there used to be an anointing session, this mother used to cry extremely bitterly. And during the Bible class, you know, I used to have a Bible class, say, one in the afternoon, the other one in the evening, the other one at night. So as soon as the time is up, I would pick up my bag to go to the next place. So there was never a time for interacting. And this mother used to come every Thursday. And one day, she broke down and she said, "My daughter, from the last 5 years, has not stepped out of the house." I said, "What happened?" She said, "My daughter with her friends had gone somewhere and she came home a little late. She was in the college that time. And her father got angry and beat her up and said, 'You are not going out of this house anymore.' He said it in a fit of anger. The girl made up her mind. She never stepped out of the house. She said, 6 months back, her brother got married. This girl did not attend the wedding. She did everything to help her brother. But she did not cross the main door. She will come up to the door, but she will not cross. It's been 5 years. She stays in a room by herself, but not willing to come out. And I said, okay, I'll come and meet her. So when I went to meet her, this girl was extremely bold. So I began to talk to her. And every time I spoke to her, she gave me a counter word. When I said, are you happy with this life? She said, extremely happy. Then I said, what's your future? She said, I've got a beautiful future. I do my business online. I sell, I buy, and I'm doing my business. I'm so happy that I don't have to go like every other person goes out and slogs. I work from home and I earn from home. The money is there, everything is there. Praise God. If not, praise God. And when she was going on talking, and she was talking with such confidence that it looked like she's the cat and I'm the rat. Believe me, she was extremely bold. If she can make that decision, Dad, you told me not to go out of the house. All my life, I'll never step out of the house. She took that word. And then she went on and on and would not give me a chance. And it looked like she cornered me. She had many reasons why she was happy. And then the Lord said, ask her. Jesus came to give you life. Life in abundance. Are you experiencing that life in abundance? Ask her. So I asked her those words. And she got so annoyed. She jumped out of the chair and straight away walked inside. And the Lord said, now go and talk to her. So I asked the mother, can I go in? She said, yes. So I went to her and I said, listen, Dad spoke out of anger. He did not mean that. Today Dad is having a miserable life. Mama is having a miserable life. Your brother is having a miserable life. Because they can see their family member is actually tormented inside this wall. God has given you the talents. God has given you the gifts. God has given you the boldness. God has given you the courage. God has given you all this. But you are using your stubbornness for that one sentence and you are making your father's life miserable. Listen, Jesus loves you so much. He wants you to be like a flower bubbling in the air. And God wants so much. He has got so much of goodness outside this house. It was only God's grace. She kept on listening. She kept on crying. We made a prayer. And I left the house. Praise God. Next morning, she got up. And she told her dad, Dad, can you take me to church? Early morning, you can imagine the dad started crying. He started crying. And he said, baby, right now, he brought the bike and she sat on the bike and he took her to church. As they went into the compound and the bike was still moving, this girl jumped out of the bike. She was like a stunt girl, you know, very bold. She jumped out of the running bike, ran into the church right in front of the altar and gave her life to Jesus. Her life completely changed from that day. Can you imagine that one line, she had such hatred that she began to speak it again and again and again. And I said to her, tell me honestly, when your brother got married, didn't you have the desire to be there? Tell me honestly. She said, yes. Then why were you not there? Because my dad told me. I said, that same dad is repenting. He wants you to come out. Well, what he said is said. That hatred, the devil kept making us stubborn and stubborn and stubborn. And I said, listen, there is so much of life still remaining. Come on. God has got something beautiful for you. You can release your dad from being stubborn. Your dad is suffering, your mom is suffering, everybody is suffering. If you let go of that stubbornness, life will become beautiful. And we began to pray. The next week when the mama came for the Bible class, she was bubbling with joy and she said, you know what? My baby is once again the same. She went out, she came back, she made new friends, she's doing a business. In this 1 week, I can't even imagine that she suffered for 5 years. Offense. When you are offended, you just handed over your whole future in the hands of Satan. And Satan built up a stronghold in her mind. So what's depression? Now what happened? One sentence. She must have played that word over and over again. And even if she wants to go out, again that word must have come. Her dad said, he beat me up that day. I will teach him a lesson. I'll never go out. She never finished her education. She never went to college after that because of her stubbornness. Her mind was leached, controlled by the enemy in this area. As for other areas, she could do a business, she could do all those things. But when it came to this area, even her brother's wedding, she helped him to do online purchase and everything. But she would not come out of the house. That stronghold. So we who are in the word of God, when we repeat the word again and again, if there can be a stronghold where the mind can be leashed with negative thoughts and captivate the person's mind, that the whole body is controlled by that stronghold of the enemy, in the same way our mind can also be controlled by the word of God. If a person is again and again thinking on God's word over and over again, like the evil spirit coming and landing, you know when a person get a thought, a negative thought, it's just a small spirit. When he keeps on thinking on the same subject over and over again, he has opened the runway for bigger spirits to come. When a person keeps on going into this depression, the person's mind is so captivated that he begins to even think how to finish up his life. It doesn't come on the first day. It is a process. And there comes a time when he wants to finish his life. He speaks defeat, he speaks fear, he speaks suicide. And a time comes when the person is captivated. The person has no control over his mind. And the person takes some poisons or takes something. And when that person has done it, now the person can feel the reaction, now the person can see the pain, and now that person begins to ask for help. Especially, you see, sometimes they put kerosene and they burn. Now when the fire is lit, now the person is crying for help. Why the person did not know it, there will be a consequences, the person knows. But during that moment, that very moment when the person is striking, that person's mind is captivated by a demonic spirit. And the only way that person can be delivered is the word of God and the presence of God and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. I'm sure without a doubt I'm speaking to somebody who's going through this. You got suicidal tendencies, that's a stronghold. That spirit has to be destroyed. When you take the word of God and you start meditating on the word of God, this word of God has the power to break the stronghold of the enemy. Might be the enemy had captivated you for 25 years, doesn't matter. This word is able to destroy it completely. That's why those scriptures, that white book concerning worry and fear and all those things, what is that? Those are hammers. That's the word of God. It breaks the stronghold of the enemy. No matter how many years you are depressed, keep on repeating it, keep on speaking it, keep on meditating it again and again. And I've got good news to you. This scriptures can be downloaded on your mobile. If you got an Android phone, go to the Play Store, type JCILM booklet, two words. If you got an iPhone, type, go to the App Store and type JCILM booklet, download it. And there is an advantage. When you go there, there are different switches. When you click on fear, worry and fear, you get an audio message. When you play the audio message, you can keep on speaking along with it. When you go to sleep, click over there, and all the four prayers, all the five prayers are there. You repeat along with it. It doesn't take much time. And if you're doing it every day before you go to sleep, four times, five times, and in the morning when you get up, before you brush their teeth, you start speaking it. You know what's happening? Without your knowledge, your mind is getting unleashed. That is speaking by heart, but what I'm saying, even if it is by heart, okay, when you put it on, you will be speaking along with that person, okay? And when you keep on practicing again and again and again, four, five times, seven times, before you go to sleep, you might keep it, when it gets over, it stops. So as long as you are awake, play it till you go to sleep. And if you're going to sleep with the scriptures, even when you're sleeping, the scriptures are going on and on till you get up. So if you sleep with the scriptures, strongholds are broken. If you sleep with worry, strongholds are constructed. Now the strongholds are out of two coins. One is of the evil one, one is of the word of God. So when the stronghold is on the word of God, now when the enemy strikes you with pressure, you are unshakable. Fortress doesn't shake. So when you are having negative thoughts and it's become a stronghold, when little pressure comes, you're all shaking around. You're speaking absolute fear. There's no question of faith. Praise God. Why did you become so serious? So can a person's mind get leached any moment? If you are not very cautious, one thought, as soon as it lands and you did not captivate it, that thought will open the door for the next thought, and the next one, and the next one. What was simple thoughts has now grown in not only in multiples, also taking you deeper into fear. Praise God. Okay. Next slide. How many of you believe that John the Baptist got offended? Hey, John the Baptist got? Okay, let's go to Matthew 11. And it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach in their cities. So Jesus was with his 12. He imparted the anointing on them. They went in different direction. Jesus went in different direction. And Jesus went to teach and preach in different cities. Now, when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said unto him, are you he that should come, or do we look for another? And Jesus answered and said unto them, go and show John, go and show John. Oh, you're not reading. Go and show John. No. I only want that word. I want you to. If that word is again, that means these disciples had come before. These disciples had come before. Go and show John again those things which you do hear and see. Now, Wasn't John the Baptist the same person who had baptized Jesus? Wasn't he the same one who saw the Holy Spirit come down from heaven, the heaven open, and come down in the form of dove? Come on. Wasn't he the same one who knew that he is the Messiah? Wasn't he the same one who also said to his disciple, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world"? Come on. So here is a person who had heard the voice, seen the vision, and also had the prophecy that is the Messiah. Is that right? Then how come in verse number 3, in verse number 2 especially, he heard in the prison the works of Christ? He sent two of his disciples for what? Are you he that should come, or do we look for another? How can a man who had such experience of God now turn around and doubt who? Hello, who? So is it possible for a man like John the Baptist that he could fall? Okay. Jesus answered and said unto them, "Go and show John again those things which you do hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up again, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me." Jesus is saying, blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in. So did John the Baptist got offended? How can he get offended? He knows that he is the Messiah. Why is he asking the question? So every time you are in a prison, you will get offended with your cousin. So you get angry. Okay, he got angry. And as they departed, who? The ones who came to ask, "Are you the Messiah?" Okay. And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, "What went you out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? What went you out to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what went you out for to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before your face, which shall prepare your way before thee. Truly I say unto you, among them that are born of woman, there has not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist." Was John the Baptist offended? Yes. Now when did Jesus say that John the Baptist is greater than any other prophet? When the disciples of John the Baptist were there, or when they had gone away? If you were in Jesus' place, when would you say that John the Baptist is the greatest one? When his disciples are there, or when his disciples are gone? Because you want them to carry this news. Hello? When do you want to say good things about people? When they are there or when they are not there? And what do you say about people when they are not there? When did Jesus say good about John the Baptist? Okay. Then he said, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. First he said, there has never been a prophet born greater than John the Baptist. So even though he is on such a high level, but now I want to tell you, even the least in the kingdom of God is greater than John the Baptist. Why? Why? When a person gets offended, no matter how high he is, that offense brings him to the lowest category. Praise God. Praise God. In the Gospel of Luke also there is, what's the chapter? In the Gospel of Luke about John the Baptist. Luke 7, verse number 18. And the disciples of John showed him of all these things. The disciples of John came and told John the things that were happening through Jesus. 19. And John calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, are you he that should come, or look we for another? Had he sent these disciples before? Yeah. Yeah. So when the men were come unto him, they said, John the Baptist has sent us unto you, saying, are you he that should come, or should we look for another? And in that same hour, hey, hold on, Ray. And in that same hour, say that, same hour. How do you feel when you are the disciple, you went and asked Jesus, John the Baptist has sent me to ask you, are you the one who has come, or do we look out for another? And he does not reply to them. For how long? Hello, for how long? 1 hour. He's not given his answer. What is he doing for 1 hour? He cured many of the infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits, and unto many that were blind he gave sight. So if a question was asked, when did Jesus answer the question? If you are the disciple, what will you say? Now what would you say if you had come to Jesus and asked him the question and he just ignores you for 1 hour, and after healing all those people, he comes and says, go your way and tell John what things you have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. Is this an answer? If somebody has to ask you, are you the one, or the one, or should we look out for another? Now you say, go and tell them what you have seen and heard. The blind can see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. Is this the answer? Funny answer, no? And on top of that, he's saying, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Lord, first of all, you are making those people stand for 1 hour. And after that, you are not even giving them the answer, yes, I am the Messiah. Instead of telling them, I am the Messiah, you are giving all the story. The blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised, the evil spirits are cast out. What kind of an answer is that? Come on, if a person is offended and is asking you, are you the one, at least say yes or no. Is it right? Okay, I'll show you why did John the Baptist get offended. Okay, let's see why he got offended, and Jesus is giving him the answer. He should not, why he should not get offended. Okay, Isaiah 61 verse 1. Now before we go there, if a person is coming and asking you again and again, are you the one we are looking for, or should we look for another? You gave the answer. The next day he comes and asks you the same question, and you gave the answer. The third time that person came, you made him wait for 1 hour, and then you gave him the answer, the same answer. Now if a person comes again and again and asks you the same question, won't you get offended? Now did Jesus get offended with John the Baptist? How do you say? Because if he had to get offended, he would have said, what kind of a man this fellow is, again and again asking me. But when his disciples are gone, Jesus is praising John the Baptist. When do we want to praise people? And when they are absent? Why are you laughing? In other words, when they are absent, you keep on laughing. What is Jesus teaching us? If you want to praise people, do you praise in front of them or when they are not there? Some fight is going on? Some song? Oh, Miranda, the Konkani session is so, and look at English session, all. English session, only one person is screaming, others are just, Konkani session, all are screaming. Okay, let me check. For the next 5 minutes, give praises. Come on, let's see. That also sound is not coming. Come on, let me hear. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name, Lord Jesus. Blessed is your name, Lord. Blessed is your name, Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Come on. Come on. Come on, lift your voices and praise Him. Come on, lift your voices and praise Him. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank God the English crowd also is awake. Praise God. Okay. Let's study this. Isaiah 61. Was one. Now this is the prophecy of the Messiah. God showed vision to Isaiah that when the Messiah will come, he will do these things. And he wrote it down. Now look what he says. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of prison to them that are bound. Then, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Can you read that, please? I want everybody to read that. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. Now, in this scripture, there are two things. The first thing he says, he will proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Means what? The favor of the Lord. He will come to proclaim the Jubilee year of the Lord. Means what? People who were slaves, in the year of Jubilee, the slaves had to be set free. So when the Messiah will come, he will declare the favor of God or the acceptable year of the Lord. That means, no matter for how many years you have been in slavery, no matter how many years you have been in captivity, you are 100% going to be set free. Okay? This was actual slavery. Okay? And at the same time, the same scripture says, and the day of vengeance. That means the Lord will come and pass his judgment and punish those who have been living a disobedient life. Okay? Now, when John the Baptist was believing that he is the Messiah, he believed this scripture, surely there will be God's favor. That means all the Jews will experience God's favor. And all the Romans during the time, the Romans were ruling, and the Romans will experience the vengeance of God. Yes. Are you understanding? Yes. So if the Messiah comes and comes with vengeance of God against the Romans, then by now Jesus should have been getting ready to fight against the Romans. He is supposed to create a revolution against the Roman Empire and destroy that kingdom and establish the kingdom of the Israelites. Correct? Now, John the Baptist is hearing in the prison the works of Christ. But at the same time, he is also hearing that Jesus is not yet training anybody to fight against the Romans. How is he going to fight against the Romans without a sword? How is he going to fight against the Romans and defeat them without an army? Come on, Jesus, I ran my race and I believe that from now on, you are the one who is going to carry on, and you have not yet spoken a word against the Roman Empire. And how are you going to establish your kingdom? How are you going to be the king? How are you going to defeat the Roman Empire? Now, what happened with John the Baptist is, he interpreted the scripture wrong. Because he interpreted the scripture wrong, he could not see Jesus getting into war. And he began to doubt that if he is the Messiah, by now he should have started something to get into the battle. But here I find the disciples of John the Baptist are coming and saying, you know what? Jesus is going around and saying the kingdom of God is at hand, but he's not yet using any sword or any fight or preparing or anything. All that he's doing is talking and talking and talking. Praise the Lord. Now I'll show you the same scripture, how Jesus is giving us a revelation of the Messiah. Luke chapter 4 verse 16. Now, did John the Baptist interpret the scripture wrong? Hello?
Yes.
In the same way, when we have wrong interpretation, or we have the wrong truths, or we have the wrong knowledge, it will always create offense in our life. Are you following? Are you following? When we have the lies of the devil, we are offended. John the Baptist got deceived. Now look at here. When Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Then, and there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." Now, did he read from the book of Isaiah?
Yes.
Come on, the same passage? Yes. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." Then, "to preach the year, acceptable year of the Lord." Now, did Jesus read everything that we read in Isaiah 61? Jesus, was it in the second scripture, was these two lines in one scripture? Did Jesus complete the scripture? He left only half. Why did he leave half? That scripture in Isaiah 61 speaks about the first coming of the Messiah and the second coming of the Messiah. When he's coming the first time, he's coming with mercy. When he's coming the second time, he's coming with vengeance. Now, when John the Baptist did not understand that, he took these two scriptures at the same time and he missed the mark. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you following? Now, how did Jesus deal with that offense? Jesus dealt with that offense by speaking to John the Baptist and telling him, "John the Baptist, the only way you can ever be delivered from any kind of offense is to go back to the truth." Have you ever seen a person all of a sudden got sick and landed up in the hospital? Okay? And when that person is in the hospital, there were some people who came and met, and some people never met. Possible? Came and met that person in the hospital, and some people never visited that person. When the person did not experience people coming and visiting, is the person offended? Come on. So there is always a reason for people to get offended. Okay? Now, what is Jesus saying? If a person is there in the hospital and offended, and then somebody comes and that person says, "You know, I did so much for this person, and now when I'm in the midst of this sickness, you see, that person has not even given me a call, that person did not even come to meet me, I'm really very hurt." Possible? And that person who has come to visit us also saying, "Yes, man, you know, in today's world, everything is like that only." Now, what is that person putting? Giving petrol. Okay. Now, is the offense going to increase?
Yes.
And then that person said, "Don't worry, let go, yaar, this and that." Now, is that person counseling by giving the scriptures?
No.
If the person is not given counseling, giving the scriptures, will that person change? No. Only the word, when the word abides in you, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So what's going to set you free from offense? The truth. And if a person is counseling you and not giving you the scriptures and showing you the truth, the person will not be free from offense. So what is Jesus trying to say? Jesus is trying to say, "Listen, I don't need to go and tell John, I'm not giving you the answer of telling John the Baptist, 'Listen, John the Baptist, I'm the Messiah.' No, it will not destroy the offense. But I want you to go and tell him that these signs that you're seeing are the signs of the Messiah. So when he goes on to the scripture will set him free from offense." When you are offended with anybody, And if somebody is coming and saying, Baba re puta re baba puta baba puta gojugu jugu adumlo, it will not get you out. But if that same person is showing you scripture after scripture after scripture and saying, see, if you are doing this, this is your condition and this is your future, what do you want to do? But if you change and you take this scripture, this is going to be an excellent future. What do you want? The person is change. So what do we need to give? The truth. Where do we need to go? First, to the scriptures. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Can we give the Lord a big hand for that? Come on. So from now on, if you're offended, where do you run first? To the truths. And especially what you're writing down, these are truths. And when your emotion is getting triggered and you want to give back and you're looking at this truth, you know you are on the losing side. Have you noticed when you are really very angry and it's boiling inside and you open your mouth, once you have given, you feel so much of relief. Don't you feel relieved? You know, the devil has to make you feel relieved. You know why? Because every time you practice that way, you are giving him a chance to attack you more. Have you heard this? When you are really hurt, you should share your sorrows with others. Tell them and you'll feel good. Empty yourself to others. You'll feel good. And you really feel good. But actually, what have you done in the spiritual realm? You just activated death, because life and death is in the power of your tongue. All that you are talking about your problems, you are talking about your death. You just activated. You will feel good, and the devil will make you feel good so that you go around telling everybody, and more you tell, the more and more death is multiplying. Feel good. People hate me when they come for counseling. You know why? Because I don't listen to their story. Because when they tell their story, I say, listen, you are telling your story, you are activating death. I don't want to hear your story. I want to hear the topic of your story. And if you can give me the topic, I can give you the solution from the Bible. Who wants your problem? Let's talk about the solution, man. The solution can fix the problem. Why do I need the details of your problem? If I can give you the details of the solution, it can go and fix every one of your problem. I'm not interested in your story. Neither is Jesus interested in your story. Jesus is interested, can you take my word and put it into practice? It will solve your problem. No, I want to tell you my story. And if the counselor wants your story, then what happened? And then what happened? And you remove all that corruption and give it to the counselor. The counselor's ears are corrupted now. Praise God. Okay, just put the slide, Baba. Jesus said, blessed are those who are not offended in him. Praise God. Are there times when people are offended with God? Is there a chance? Okay. Let's say. A youth went with his friends. That night he was on the bike. And he was driving at a great speed, lost his balance, had an accident, extremely serious, and after 1 month died. Now was that death God's plan for his life? Hello? But is there a chance for a person to blame God for that death? Yes. And be angry with God? Now who killed a child? Jesus said, the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Who tempted him? The thief. Who got him do those actions? The thief. And when he destroyed him, who got the blame? So Jesus clearly mentions that it's the thief who comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I've come to give you life, life in abundance. So if the son was listening to the thief and taking decisions and making actions based on that, and he got destroyed, so what is it, God's fault? Now, has God given everybody the freedom of choice? Yes. How did he use his freedom? So many a times people don't understand the truth and they are angry with God. And when they are offended, the one who is able to save him, the one who is able to break the curse, the one who is able to set you free, if you are offended, you just short-circuited your freedom. You just short-circuited your miracle. And that's what happened with John the Baptist. The very person who could have saved him was Jesus. But when he got offended, he closed the door for Jesus to help him, deliver him, and his head got beheaded. So remember, offense is a blessing blocker. Offense is a blessing blocker. It is a negative reaction to a condition or a comment.
What about if it was not his fault and somebody...
Sorry, whose fault? What did you learn today about that lady who had coma? She was in the Word of God for the last 5 years. What was she doing? She had built a foundation. She had a deposit of God's scriptures in her life. How many people have scripture deposit in their life? Everybody is more conscious about how much is the deposit in the bank. How much is deposit of scriptures in the bank of scriptures? You know what she said, this lady? She said, brother, if I share my testimonies, there are so many testimonies that I've experienced in my 5 years. And I want to tell you, even when I was going through this, I had confidence because I had already seen so many things happening in my life. Now, how many people build their life on scriptures and have deposit of scriptures? What did I say now? We have made an application that on the mobile you get the audio scriptures. You put it on and you speak it 5 times at night, 5 times in a day, in the morning. Is it easy? Oh, yes. Now, when your person is doing this again and again and again, what is he doing? Making deposits. And based on those deposits, those things will manifest in its due season. Have you ever seen a farmer get a harvest without planting seeds? But what about a Christian? A Christian does not plant seeds in his heart, that is God's scriptures, but expecting protection and blessings from God. Do you understand? What about a person who is speaking the scriptures but at the same time having fear? What about Job? He was worshipping God. He was offering sacrifice every day. He was a good man, but all his children died. What was the reason? His own fear. So we cannot pass a judgment why this happened, because we never know what was the person thinking in his private life. If a person keeps thinking and keeps saying, next year this time I will be dead, you know what he just did? He just activated the spirit of death. And if he is meditating on that, those things come to pass. Because you are the one who is going to activate life or death. And that's why God is saying, listen, offense is one of the tools the devil uses mightily among us Christians. Even though I'm a believer, even though I speak God's word, but offense, because we thought offense is okay, it's okay to get offended. But here the scripture clearly shows that when you get offended, you are out of God's protection. And Jesus also said, the least in the kingdom of God will be greater than John the Baptist. Why? The moment he got offended, his level from that high level reached to the lowest level. Offense is a blessing blocker. It's a negative reaction. Change the slide, please. Please read that. If there are things going wrong in our life, it may be... Change the slide. It may be due to offense. If you are a person who is all the time getting offended, your life will be miserable. Even if God has got great plans for you, those plans will not manifest. Both of you are not writing? Writing? Husband is not writing? I had once a couple in my Bible class, and every week the wife used to come and write, and the husband used to sit by her side and keep watching when I used to give dictation. And I asked him, you don't write? He said, she is writing. I said, okay. So when you go home, do you use her clothes? The next week he started writing. Okay? After 7 months, he got a paralytic stroke. And I went to the hospital to meet him. The husband and wife were there, and both of them were laughing and laughing and laughing. And I said, you got a stroke and you're laughing? He said, I got a stroke, but the stroke has no power over me, because I know the word that I have is able to destroy all this sickness and get me back on my health. No joke. And when I looked at them, I said, do you know what? I feel like you did not get room in your house, and that's why it looks like you are a honeymoon couple in the hospital, and both of you, he's on one bed, they had a special room, he's on one bed and she's on the other bed. I said, good, children are at auntie's place and you both are like couples having enjoyment in the hospital. And they said, brother, if it wouldn't have been for the word, we would have been depressed. We would have looked at the report and we would have been depressed. But having known the truth, we know that the truth is able to destroy. And the person was completely healed within a month. He came out of all that completely, totally healed. Praise God. Hallelujah. And that same person even used to have asthmatic attack. And I remember he having that asthmatic attack and he could barely breathe. And at Porvorim, after you take after the circle, you take a turn on the left-hand side, about 100 meters, there's an hospital. I don't know what's the name. We came up to the hospital. I don't know what the name. Okay, I came over there, parked the vehicle, and I was about to take him in. And he said, brother, just give me 1 minute, please. And he vomited. Okay? And he said, you know what, brother, when I vomited, I believe that asthma just left with this vomit out of me. I believe it in the name of Jesus. So he needed that puff. Okay? And I said, okay, I'm ready to believe you. At least let's take that puff. Don't use it. He said, brother, I want to make a choice. All my life I've been taking that. This is the first time I want to live without that, believing in Jesus. Can you give me a chance? And I said, okay. We made that prayer over there in agreement, and we took a turn and we came back. Years have gone by, I think 12 years more. I still, whenever I meet him, I will ask him, hey, what about that asthma? He says, do you remember we took a turn over there from that day till today, I've never had an asthmatic attack. Now, what if this brother, whom I said to him these words, and had to get offended, would he come to the Bible class? Come on. I did not speak to him private. I just spoke to him with all the other students. And that very moment he made a decision. And he said, you know, brother, now I realize that when you are giving dictation notes and I'm writing those notes, first thing I have to attentively hear, because here there's a PowerPoint. In the Bible class there was no PowerPoint. I have to hear it attentively. I have to write it down. And when I'm writing it down, God speaks to me the same words connected to my life, which I was not experiencing when I was listening. Because when I was listening, not hearing. I was looking at you, but my mind was somewhere else. But if I have to write down, my mind can't go anywhere wandering. I have to be attentive, because otherwise I won't be able to write. Tomorrow, will I see you writing, Baba? Yes. Thank you. Are you offended? You know, I'm looking at you and all the others are saying, tomorrow we will come to write. It's your choice. But I want to tell you, these are the truths. When you apply these truths, you are guaranteed results. Now your life is no longer a luck game. Now your game is, let's play the game, devil. All this time you were fooling me and I did not know these truths. I always reacted with my natural human attitude, but now I know the truth. Come on, let's play one more time. And the more he plays the games, the more better training you get, the more better preparation you get, the more better result you get. Praise God. Hallelujah. So, if there are things going wrong in our lives, it may be due to offense. John began to question and doubt Jesus' mission. Do you question God's word? There are two kinds of people who question God's word. There were the Pharisees who had the scriptures in their heart, but their minds were filled with corruption. And every time they saw Jesus do wonders and miracles, they came to trap him and they asked questions. Did they ask questions to know the truth, or they asked questions to trap him? What about Mother Mary? She also asked a question to Angel Gabriel. How is it possible? Now, did she ask question to trap Angel Gabriel or to believe? Now, the question is, when you ask questions, do you ask questions that you don't want to obey? Or do you ask questions because you want to know the truth so that you can obey better? Are you following? So when sometimes people come and ask me questions, I first scan that person to know, is he coming from the Pharisee group or is he coming from the Mother Mary group? If he's coming from the Pharisee group, the best answer I've got is, I don't know. So if he'll ask me again, I'll say, I don't know. Third time he'll ask me, I'll say, I don't know. So when he says, why do you don't know? I don't know. When I say, I don't know, you can't force me to answer the question. And if a person comes with a Mother Mary attitude, I don't mind sitting with that person for a long time and making that person understand, so that that person will believe. Some people want to ask you questions for argument. Some people want to ask questions, for example, please don't drink. The next question, didn't Jesus make wine? Why did you ask that question? Because I don't want to stop my drinks. If Jesus drank, I'm drinking. Okay, that's enough. Did you get blessed?
Yes, surely.
Hello, did you get blessed?
Yes.
Let's close our eyes. Loving Father, thank you for this wonderful topic of offense. You showed us through even a man like John the Baptist who got offended. Lord, every time we listen to the lies of the devil, when we do not understand the truth, when we are ignorant, when we are injected by the deceiving spirit, by the lies of the devil, we quickly react. Our attitudes are negative and it destroys our life. Lord, thank you for showing us that it is extremely sinful in your sight for us to be bitter, angry, offended, and in strife. Thank you for showing us, O Lord, that by forgiving others, we are not doing a favor on them, but actually speaking, we are doing a favor for ourselves. By forgiving others, we refuse to short-circuit your love. But when we are quick to forgive, we are empowered to win. We are empowered to victory. Lord, thank you for teaching us these truths. Help us to apply it in our day-to-day life and experience more and more of your presence in our life. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.